The last talk of this session is given by Kamil Korzekwa from Kraków, and he's going to tell us about encoding classical information in quantum resources. Kamil, there you go.
Hey, hello everyone. Thanks a lot for the possibility to talk about not so recent anymore results from a little bit more than a year now. Before I proceed, let me just introduce my collaborators. That's Bishek from Gliwice, Marco from Singapore now, and Karol from Kraków. And the outline of the talk will be as follows. So I will start with a few bits of motivation. So I will tell you about communication scenarios. Because the whole point of this talk will be to relate communication scenarios, quantum communication scenarios, to the developing field of resource theories. So once we have this communication scenario in our head, then I will get to results, and I will tell you first, what kind of results did we obtain about optimal encoding of classical information to resources, the various resources. And once we have the technical result, I will discuss a few possible applications. And then it will be the outlook. And I don't think there will be any time for the sketch of the proofs, but it's there so that if you ask questions, technical questions, I am prepared to answer them, I hope. Okay, so what's the traditional communication scenario? We have one party, usually called Alice, and she wants to send one of the set of M messages. And what does she do in the quantum communication scenario? Well, she's preparing a set of M quantum states, here denoted by rho M, and this is known as encoding. And then she's sending this quantum system through a channel, usually a communication channel that is usually noisy, so that it arrives after some changes to the other side, to the other party, usually called Bob. And now the aim of Bob is to decode this. So he's getting it as an input, the noisy output from Alice, and he has to guess what message was there. So he has to guess some M to the label M, so the message M. And the way he's doing this is, well, he can do some decoding P of M, and he's gonna decode it with some probability. And now the whole aim of this traditional communication scenario is to try to, for a given noise channel, so you characterize your communication channel and you then try to find the best encodings and best decodings so that Alice and Bob can communicate pretty well. And you see, in this standard traditional scenario, we can look at this as the sender being all powerful, meaning that, well, there are usually no constraints on the encodings made by Alice are made. So she can prepare any state through M she wants. Similarly, Bob can prepare, it can use any P of M he wants. So there's no restriction on the kind of measurements he can perform. This is like the very general scenario. The only control that we don't have is the in the middle, right? This is a noise channel that we don't have the control over. There's some noise, and the whole idea is to just try to find optimal schemes to fight against this noise. And so we try to look at a slightly modified scenario, communication scenario. Now, what we have is Alice, and she still wants to send one of M messages to Bob, but she doesn't have, she can't prepare all possible quantum states. Instead, she's constrained to performing some operations on the information carrier state. So she's given some state raw that we interpret as the, you know, information carrier on which you can record your information. And she can perform some CPTP maps, some quantum channels on it before she sends it. And then those encodings will be somehow constrained. We'll discuss in a second how. And then for simplicity now, I mean, this is the beginning, we're gonna assume there is no noise, okay? I mean, we later improve this result to some particular standard noises, but like, let's assume that there is no noise, just to focus on the important aspects of this problem. And then Bob doesn't change. We didn't modify Bob, right? So Bob can also do any kind of POVMs and any kind of decoding. So now this scenario can be seen as, well, the receiver is still all powerful. Well, we have perfect control over channel. This is not fundamental. This is like for simplicity of the presentation, let's say. And then the sender is constrained. She can only prepare states that can be achieved from some given information carrier raw, being processed by a subset of channels that have some property. Okay, so let's see what kind of constraints do we study then. So I will tell first mathematically what constraints do we study and then what does it correspond to physically. So mathematically, we only look at those channels, EM, those encoding channels, EM, that have this kind of, it's not commutation, this kind of relation for some fixed idempotent channel. So there is, we choose some fixed idempotent channels, a projection channel, and this encodings have to satisfy the following relation. And an example of this is so that just to think about this idempotent channel, for example, it's the G-twirling channel that we will use later, which is like the average over all unitary permutations of some group. Now, okay, this looks a little abstract. Maybe we just make something out of our head, but let's think physically, what does it mean? So we have a system, raw, and it has some degrees of freedom. There are different energy levels or spin degrees of freedom, rotationally invariant and rotationally not invariant degrees of freedom. And then we're gonna consider some resource-destroying map. So it's, what's a resource-destroying map? It's gonna erase information from some degrees of freedom. And those encodings that we allow are exactly those encodings that encode information or change only those degrees of freedom that this resource-destroying map is erasing. So this resource-destroying map is basically just characterizing in what degrees of freedom we want to encode our information. An example, a simple example here is, resource destroying map being the completely dephasing map. So, you know, it's a completely dephasing map. It sends every state to a diagonal state. And so the corresponding encodings would be those encodings that only encode information in the phase degrees of freedom or the off-diagonal elements of the density matrix. Okay. So now we know what the communication scenario is. So Alice is constrained. We know what kind of constraints she faces. And now let's introduce, before I can present the results, I need to introduce the crucial quantities. So the average probability of decoding error is defined as, well, the average probability of decoding error. So how well you can, on average, the communication between Alice and Bob will go. Then the optimal number of messages that can be encoded in raw, using those encodings constrained by D or this resource destroying map, so that the average decoding error is smaller than epsilon, would be MD. So basically MD tells us, well, in state raw, you can encode, let's say if MD is five, for some epsilon, let's say 1%, it means that using state raw and those constraints, Alice can send five messages to Bob with an average error of one. And this is the optimal, right? The MD is denoting the optimal number of messages. And then the standard way, so we go to asymptotic limit, meaning, well, let's think that we don't have just a single copy of raw, but we start having many copies of raw, and we look at the encoding error rate. So how many kind of messages can we encode per one copy of a given state? So those are the three crucial quantities that the results will tell us something about, those three quantities. Okay, so first result is the general single shot upper bound. So this is the upper bound for the number of messages. So for any kind of constraint described by the resource-destroying map D, and any state raw and any error epsilon, the number of messages will be upper bounded by this expression, which is the exponentiated hypothesis-testing relative entropy between a state and a state with a removed resource. So we can kind of see that this is the quantifier of a resource. As you can see, the distance, some kind of a distance, pseudo distance between a state and a state with removed resource. And then and this is single shot, so that's for any kind of state. So now for particular resource destroying maps, which are G-twirling maps, we can get even more. And we have both the lower and upper bounds for this number of messages. Okay, they are expressed in a kind of maybe abstract for most of you quantity that is the information spectrum relative entropy. This is kind of technical. So the biggest advantage of this result is that we can, that those relative information spectrum relative entropy have a really nice asymptotic behavior, and this bounds lower and upper actually allow us to get an exact second order expansion of the rate. So now what does it mean? It means that now if you take state raw and n copies of this state and you allow for error epsilon and you want to find out how many messages can you encode per one copy, what you're going to get is, you're going to get the standard relative entropy between a state and its G-twirled version. And then you will get the first order correction that scales like 1 over square root of n, and it has this relative entropy variance here. And then there's going to be this correction where this phi to minus 1 is the inverse of the cumulative distribution function of a normal distribution. And then there's going to be just factors of log n over n. So this is up to second order exact equation. So this is like both achievable and optimal. Maybe a few words about those quantities. You can because I guess everybody knows the relative entropy. The relative entropy variance is maybe a less well-known concept. So let me say a few words here. If you look at the relative entropy, if you look at the definition, you can actually interpret it as the average, because trace of rho in a state rho, of some operator log rho minus log sigma. So relative entropy variance is exactly this idea that you treat this as a some kind of an observable, and you say, well, this is the average of this observable squared minus the average squared. So this is the relative entropy variance. And well, this phi to minus one, maybe it's not, we are not used to use the inverse function. It's not to minus one like one over, it's the inverse. So I drew this guy here. So you can see that, well, if you want a rate that is bigger than the asymptotic rate, so if you want this correction term to be bigger than zero, then well, your error has to be larger than 1/2. If you want to have small error, this very quickly, this term becomes negative. So basically this tells us that this second order expansion, what it gives us is tells us, well, if you don't have infinitely many copies, you cannot use the law of large numbers. So you have to have like correction with n, and usually you will get a smaller rate than the asymptotic rate. And yeah. That's kind of it. So let's see. So those are technical results. Like, okay, so encode decrease and so on. And now, and I also maybe you feel a little confused about, because I'm all the time talking about this, about the resource destroying map, that is maybe a little abstract. But the reason for this is because this gives us a really general framework now, and we can apply this to a few sensible settings. So let me start with the first one.
Kamil, can I just stop you?
Of course. Yes, of course.
So in this equation, the rate is a function of rho, which is, I guess, some state, right?
Yes, yes.
But previously, like, the encoding was a set of states, no?
Yes. So this rho is this information carrier. So in this scenario, you are given n copies of rho, and you can and you want to, out of this n copies of rho, you want to find as many orthogonal states, so distinguishable states, as you can, by using only a constrained set of channels. So you see, it's a little bit like I give you a floppy drive. This is your state rho. Okay, maybe CD. Okay, it's all old. But anyway, I give you a floppy drive. This is my state rho. And I tell you, well, you cannot do any kind of encoding. You cannot do any kind of encoding. You can only do some constrained kind of encoding. How much information can you encode on this floppy drive?
So okay, maybe. Maybe rho is like an initial state,
yes,
to which you apply some encoding from
exactly.
Strain set. Okay,
you can think of this as like you try to get the maximal orbit of a given state. So let's say if I tell you only you can take a qubit and you can only rotate around the z axis, then if I give you the eigenstate of z, then well, you cannot get anywhere. But if I give you a plus, you can go from plus to minus, and you can encode two messages because plus and minus are orthogonal.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and last quick question. So here you said that for finite n, you often get a lower rate than the asymptotic, which is kind of what we expect. But is it possible to also get higher rate than the asymptotic?
As you see, you can get the higher rate. So how can you get the higher rate? This is variance. So this is a positive number. This is n. This is a positive number. The only negative number, if we ignore the corrections log n over n, is this guy. Pi to minus one of epsilon, and you have it here, graphed here, and you see if you want it a positive, you need to allow for error bigger than 1/2. So then it's not really achievable. I mean, it is achievable if you allow for a very big error.
Okay, that explains. Cool, thank you.
Thanks for good questions. Maybe I hope that also clarified for other people some things. Okay, so application one, well, now we can choose different groups. So we use this G-twirling channel. Let's say we use the group of all unitaries. So the G-twirling channel, which is like the average over all unitaries now, is just a channel that sends everything to a maximally mixed state. And now, so the corresponding allowed encodings are all the unital maps. So now you can get the in the communication scenario where Alice is given some state rho and she cannot decrease its mixedness or cannot dump entropy, so she can only do unital channels or only do thus unitaries actually. The rate is simply given by this log d minus d entropy. So the bigger the entropy, the less information you can encode because your state is too mixed. And then the second order rate is just the relative, not the relative entropy variance, just the entropy variance. Well, a second application, you can say like, well, let's choose a different group. Let's choose a group that is unitary is diagonal in a fixed basis I, or you can call it the maximal set of mutually commuting unitaries. Then the corresponding G-twirling map will be just the defacing map in this particular basis. And well, the encodings that you can do are all those that are population preserving maps. So you cannot, change. There are no jumps between different energy levels. You can only change coherences. And a communication scenario is basically the sender can only control the phase degrees of freedom. So let's say if your system is a five level system with some energy levels, let's assume that that there is a constraint on the changing the energy of the system. You cannot change the energy of the system. You can only add some phase degrees of freedom. So let's say from a state plus, you can do state minus for a qubit. And then you find out that the optimal encoding rate is connected to the relative entropy between a state and its defaced version. This is also known as the relative entropy of coherence. So this maybe adds one more operational interpretation of this relative entropy of coherence, which is basically, well, this is the amount of information you can encode in phase degrees of freedom. And then there's also this relative entropy variance term as well. So you can get this kind of correction. Well, maybe the most well-known quantum information scenario is the teleportation and super dense coding. So we can also do this. So now let's choose a group G that is all unitaries that are just acting on one subsystem A of a bipartite system AB. Then the G-twirling map that we get is basically, well, on the first system, it just throws everything and reprepares a maximally mixed state. And on the B system, it doesn't do anything. So we have just the reduced state of the B system. And so the encodings are only like local unital channels on state A. So Alice can only do something on her side. And well, we also can get this nice rate then, which is given by conditional entropy and conditional entropy variance. And this is exactly the super dense coding scenario. So basically, imagine that Alice and Bob have some state rho AB shared between them. And now Alice wants to do something on her side, and then she sends this system, you know how this goes, right? So they have two parties. So she can do something on her side, on her side, some quantum operations, and then she sends her system to Bob so that Bob has the access to the final system. And now the question is, how many messages can she encode for Bob by doing exactly this local operations there? And so we get the optimal super dense coding capacity or whatever rate, encoding rate, when we are restricted to local unital channels. Maybe an interesting comment here is that I think that exactly the same rate goes is known when there was no restriction of unitality. So it seems like unital channels are optimal here. Okay, one more application here. Well, there is this whole field of quantum reference frames when you have this division between what information is physical, let's say, or speakable and unspeakable, where you say, well, some degrees of freedom are very physical. Let's say if you have a spin up and spin down, when I say the state is in a spin up state, it's spin up with respect to what? It's with respect to some external axis. So you have to know what is the z-axis of Alice that prepares it. So if you can have a private, let's say, a private shared reference frame so that both Alice and Bob knows where the z-axis is, but the eavesdropper doesn't know it, then so this is the scenario, right? Alice wants to prepare, let's say, some spin up or down state according to z-axis, and Bob also has exactly the same z-axis and he knows where the z-axis is, but the eavesdropper doesn't know it. Then, what she has to do is she has to average over all possible positions of her reference frame with respect to their shared reference frame. And this average is exactly given by G-twirling. So what she can see is she can, if they use these encodings that are into the, those encodings that are, that we consider here with those constraints, every state that they encode, she will see as G-twirled, and then she will see by the fact that we have those constraints. You remember this very first condition that d times em was just d. So she cannot distinguish between any of those states. So basically, what we get here, this maximal number of messages that we get that can be encoded using those maps that satisfy constraints, blah, blah, is actually the maximal number of messages that you can communicate privately or like securely if the eavesdropper doesn't have your reference frame, your access to your reference frame. And of course, this is like, I use this for, as an example here, the Cartesian reference frame, but this acts for any kind of reference frame. So also phase degrees of freedom like U1 theory and so on. Okay, and maybe the final one, I still have, I think, 5 minutes. The final application here is to thermodynamics. So now all these applications I said was for the resource destroying maps that were chosen to be G-twirling maps. And now let me go to something different and say like, well, you can also take a resource destroying map to be, for example, a thermalizing map. So it's a map that sends every system, every state to a thermal equilibrium state. What does this, what kind of encodings we then have, our constraints give us? Well, those are equilibrium preserving operations. So this is the simplest model of CPTP maps that are thermodynamically free. It's basically Gibbs, they're known as Gibbs preserving maps or GP maps. Though this is like the simplest model, because if you allow for more, then you can break the second law of thermodynamics. Basically, this says that if you are given a thermal state, you cannot move it out of equilibrium for free, because otherwise you would be able to build a perpetuum mobile. So for this set of maps, what we kind of get is that, so those are, okay, so one more time, this is the model for the simplest model for thermodynamically free encodings. And what we get is, well, we find out that the amount of information that you can encode in a system is directly related to the free energy of the system. So, okay, generalized free energy, because free energy, the standard one from the 19th century, is just for thermal equilibrium states. Here are also non-equilibrium states. And we also get this correction that is related to generalized heat capacity, because we know that the relative entropy variance between a state and a Gibbs state can be interpreted as generalized heat capacity. So it's a nice connection now again with, it's a nice connection again between thermodynamics and information theory, but now exactly on the information side. So it's a little bit like with the Szilard. So the Szilard engine tells us that if you have some information, you can extract work. And here, well, if you have some free energy, so some work, then you can encode some information. So the amount of free energy of in the system tells us how much information you can encode into it. But still, as you see, this is only the upper bound. So I will go now to Outlook because I have 3 more minutes. And you will see that we are working on this. So this was only because we, as you remember, we had the lower and upper bounds for the G-twirling maps, but for general ones, and this is not the G-twirling map, we only had the upper bound. So let's go to Outlook. Yeah, I gave a few examples of unitary subgroups that had some operational relevance. But you know, if you have your favorite unitary group that could work here, you can just stick it into our result. If you have any constraints that are encoded by this, you can just stick it there and find the optimal communication rate. Then the second one being like trying to find the single shot lower bounds for general resource destroying maps. So optimally, we would like to find those lower bounds that would coincide with the upper bounds up to second order asymptotic, so that we can get this result as we got for G-twirling maps for any other constraints. And then in particular, we'd like to study this in a thermodynamically free encoding setting. So when this resource destroying map is a thermalizing map. So analysis to the of the communication side through a noisy channels. You already did this. I didn't have much time to discuss this as, so basically remember that I said that in this scenario, you assume that the noise, there's no noise. But we actually found out that some noises like partial dephasings or partial G-trillings we can deal with. So we can do this whole scenario a little bit more realistic. And maybe for a general group G, maybe we'd like also to find optimal states for encoding information. So like those states that are maximally not invariant under some group representation. That's an interesting project as well, I think. And maybe finally, yeah, because this work was submitted a year ago, in this particular case, for thermodynamically free encoding of information, we're going to have soon a paper on archive. So if you are interested in this, you should check archive in March. This should appear soon. And thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, Kamil, thanks. Thanks very, very much for a nice talk. So maybe I would like to start with a question just to clarify. I guess your results like in order to kind of apply your results, I just need a resource destroying map, right?
Yes.
That's all I need, and then I can compute these things and
yes.
Right? Okay, and is there any restriction on like what is a resource destroying map? Like any map, or does it have to satisfy something?
Yeah, it has to satisfy, as I said at the very beginning, it has to be an idempotent map, meaning simply that applying it twice should leave the state mm-hmm. unchanged. And a projector. And then apart from that, nothing else. You can choose anyone. Obviously, if you choose a weird one, you will not have a physical interpretation of what these constraints are. Mm-hmm. So as you've seen, the ones that we chose were only related to either G-Trialing map, which had some interpretation, and the thermalizing map, which we also had some interpretation. But like, if you find some other interpretation, then yeah, you can use any map you want here.
Okay, so I guess the reason why you use these maps, which can be written as averages over unitaries, is because they just have some interpretation.
They have some interpretation, exactly. Exactly. So especially, for example, in the case of, encodings into entanglement, simply because then you really have the operational interpretation as Alice doing something on her side. This is like a standard scenario, right? When she can do anything she wants on her side.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I guess in this case, the resource destroying is like a completely depolarizing channel on...
Yes, exactly. Oh, okay. It's a completely depolarizing on one side. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Cool. Okay, and I have a question from Mate Farkas, which I'm going to read it out now. Okay. Consider the reverse question. There is some classical information encoded on quantum carriers, and Alice aims at erasing this information. Can your methods be adapted to the verification of such erasure in some way?
That's interesting. So if those encoded messages, maybe that's going to be avoiding maybe the real answer, but giving some answer. If those encodings are exactly the ones that we use here, the way to erase it is basically exactly to use the resource destroying map. But I think what Mate is asking is a little more general, being if you have some states, is there a way that maps all those states to the same, like some minimal channel, erasure channel that would kill the information between those encoded in those states. Obviously, you can always choose the maximally depolarizing channel, right? You have some set of states, you apply a maximally depolarizing channel, but maybe that's a little bit too much, right? Because sometimes, let's say, if you have a state plus and minus, you don't need a maximally depolarizing, you just need a dephasing channel. So, yeah, that's an interesting question. It could be formalized in many different ways. So one would have to think really of how to rigorously frame this problem. But yeah, thanks a lot. That's interesting.
Okay, so Mate, you should rigorously formalize this question. Okay, this was the last talk of this session. So thanks very much for all the speakers.